Wiley is Endicott's fifth and current president. Prior to assuming that role in 1987, he served as a professor and administrator at the University of Connecticut, Temple University, University of Colorado, and Lesley College. He holds a bachelor's degree from Plymouth State College and a master's doctorate degree from Boston University. Please give a warm welcome for Dr. Richard Wiley.
It's not old age that took me up these stairs like that. I've been watching the geese lay eggs and how they hatch them, and I just kind of practiced that. I just had my knees replaced in November and December and at Beverly Hospital, and I have to tell you, nobody could have done it better, and nobody could have done it better than those doctors. As my wife said to me, she said, "Now you're going to be able to weed the garden." And I said, "My dear, I did not do my knees to weed the garden." I'm going to take a couple of detours to the topic by first suggesting to us, I'm going to put some numbers up on the screen here, and if I mess it up, I'm going to look for help because I am not technologically advanced. I am absolutely a paper and pencil person. So I'm going to put a number up there. Any idea what that number represents? Salaries of the public officials in the room, yes. That is the economic impact of the colleges and universities in Massachusetts each year. There we go. Do I need some help? Yes, I need all the help I can get. This number is the economic impact in New England. $118 billion. What's that number? The number of college students enrolled in higher education in Massachusetts. Higher education in Massachusetts is big business. And if we don't recognize it as big business, we're losing sight of one of the most important engines that exists in this country, and particularly in New England and in this area. Taking those statistics for a minute, I'm going to suggest that higher education is under terrible fire, criticism from all aspects. Certainly from parents saying tuition is too high, to students saying I'm in debt too much, to the federal government saying we've got to control costs, and if you don't control the costs, we're going to cut your financial aid. Greater quality, more accountability, increased restrictions, media attention to student debt, government that threatens the loss of financial aid, corporate expectations, and student and family expectations. These are challenges. And we're going to see a number of things coming to the surface that are going to reduce the cost of education. The question is, will it increase the quality of education? Or will it diminish the quality of education that you as businesses need to advance yourself, to make new products, and to create new businesses and new energies? We see special reduction tuition programs. Bill Gates said in 2010 that you should be able to get a four-year college education using technology for $2,000 total for 4 years. Florida and Texas have now turned around and they have bachelor's degrees that are that cost $10,000. In a New England state, there's an associate's degree is $2,500. We have MOOCs and all these non-credit courses that are out there that if you take the course, you don't get credit, but some other institution can give you a test and then give you credit for it. Where do we go? We're entering the helter-skelter innovation and cost containment. Is it good or bad? We simply don't know the answer. I would contend that higher education has failed in many ways. It has failed to educate well our diverse populations, our first-generation Americans, and students who really don't care enough to educate themselves and be part of an educated community. We used to talk about the helicopter parents, you're spinning overhead, you protect your child. Then it became the dive bomber, they went right after your jugular vein. Now it's the snowplow, they get in front of the child, or their son and daughter, because they're not children, of course, and they make sure that nothing interferes with what they want. So today, I would like to say to us, to this group, we have a big challenge in higher education, and we need your guidance. We need your support. Are you going to be hiring people that have never been in a college course or class, that have done it all from home? Maybe you will. Maybe it's a good way to do it. Are you going to be hiring people who have never dealt with the growth of life that goes on in college for 4 years? It's a challenge, and we're all facing it. The transition from higher education, from public high school to through higher education to work, requires, in my estimation, real work experience. It requires the fact that interns and students get practical experiences. I was not prepared to be president of a college. I had no idea what it was about. I didn't realize that I could have sexual assaults. I could have deficit budgets. I could have more snow than I budgeted for. That I could have a faculty union that says no. That all of these things I was not prepared for. No textbook in higher education taught me any of those things. Saturday morning at 1:30, I get a phone call on my cell phone. Doc, I can't get a taxi, can you help me? 1:35 in the morning. Well, I've always said to my kids, if you have trouble, call me. Well, we got him, but I have his number, and boy is he in trouble. But if we take a look at where we are with internships, and that's what I'm supposed to talk about, and I will take a couple of minutes on it, this has been the heart and soul of Endicott College. Every year we put 1,500 internships out into the community. 80% of them are on the North Shore. 41% of them get a job offer or a significant job lead from their internship. We have over 25,000 businesses that want interns, and they register with us. We use some internship sites many times, and others we use it once or twice. But one of the things that it comes down to is the fact that a student said to me one day, a freshman who did a short-term internship, she said, I didn't learn anything on my internship. And I said, nothing? She said, nothing. It was a waste of time. I said, what did you do? She said, I worked in the business office there. I said, what did you see? Well, you know, people were, they really didn't like working there, so they left their resumes in the Xerox machine as they were making copies to send it elsewhere. What else? Well, you know, the boss, he leaves at 1 o'clock every day and plays golf. Another one is, hey, he's having an affair with a girl down the street. And I said, what did you learn? She said, nothing. I said, you learned more about human resources than anybody reading a textbook. Because textbooks don't generally talk about those kinds of things. So I think part of this gets down is how do we take together the issues of high cost, quality, government intervention, all these alternative ways, and what do we say is good education? Good education to me is a strong liberal arts background with a professional training with internships. We need you as businesses and as corporations, as individuals, to help us educate our students through the internship process, to mentor, to guide, to assist them. There is no greater reward than the ability to look at a young person and see in the depths of their eyes success. They haven't seen it, they don't know it's there, but you can give it to them, you can help them have it. And then that constant mentoring that goes with internships. That will counteract, and there will be students that want to be online for their courses. And I have nothing against online education, except there's one ad that just drives me up the wall. It shows this young girl sitting on her bed in her shorty pajamas, and she says, "And I'm going to college, and I'm doing it all from my bedroom." And you've seen that, and it's the antithesis of quality. So tonight, at this noon, I ask you to look at your corporations and your businesses. Help us place interns. Every one of these colleges, help hire our graduates. Help nurture our graduates. But more importantly, tell us what we're not doing right. What you need from us that we're not doing. And hold us accountable. It should not be the government that holds us accountable. It should not be test scores that hold us accountable. It should be the industries and the businesses that we are preparing graduates for. We need a regional philosophy about applied learning, about job success, and about colleges meeting those needs. So today, I thank you for the opportunity to speak with you a little bit about some of the internships.